Hi everybody, my name's Kate and I'd like to welcome you to the National Capital Exhibition. I'd like to pause for a moment and take this time to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land that we're meeting on and to pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. My topic today is about landscape and the way the national capital developed and the way that landscape was cultivated in the early 1900s. We are going to look at some individuals. These are largely foreigners, people that come to terms with the landscape with new eyes. So I really want to make the point that these are not people that have a developed understanding of place. It is very much something about the stark newness as foreigners that possibly gives us the Canberra that we have today. All right, when we think about Indigenous Australians, we know that they have an affinity for landscape, a knowledge, an understanding for country that is developed and cultivated over thousands and thousands of years. The people that I'm going to be looking at today are the Griffins, the dynamic duo, Walter and Marion. The Griffins, who came here in 1912 as newlyweds, having won an international design competition for Canberra. And then the other individual I'll introduce slightly later is Charles Weston. And he was the horticulturalist coming from the Botanic Gardens in Sydney and an Englishman. So we've got two Americans and an Englishman, and it's how they come together to flavour the national capital in those early years. So Walter and Marion, they came out from America. They are looking at the Australian landscape like foreigners. They're seeing a place that is virtually unknown to them. They've got a little bit of a hint of what Australia was like from the design competition and the components that were sent to them in terms of topography ahead of time. But really, once they got here, they were absolutely blown away. Marion comments on the blue skies of Australia and says there's nothing like it anywhere else in the world. She talks about the spirituality of the eucalyptus trees and she sets herself this task to really sketch them and paint them down. So that's important to them. The other thing I think that's really important is that they're chasing a symbolism in the Australian landscape. So how do they go about that? Well, if we look to their design, we see straight away we've got the National Triangle. The other thing that we see is, and I'm going to show you a slide right now, is we have Marion's view. Now, Marion's view is from the summit of Mount Ainslie, as we know it today. We now call it Marion's view, and it looks down to Anzac Parade and extends to Mount Bimbury, which is about 25 kilometres away. So that's the central land axis that I'm talking about today and what they are responsible for achieving. But it's not only the achievements of Walter and Marion that bring this to the fore, it's also the work of another creative gentleman. And maybe it's time to go and meet him now. Hi, I'd like to introduce you to another friend of mine. His name is Charles Weston. And he does have quite a dashing moustache, I know. It was one of his defining features. So Charles Weston, he was the man of science. Now, Weston worked in very methodical ways. He experimented. He knew what worked, what didn't work. He was interested in some horticultural and landscape design. He certainly had followed some of the Garden City movements before coming to Australia, things that were coming across from England and the United States at the turn of the century. But really, Charles Weston what drove him was he wanted to know what was going to work and what was going to grow in this climate. I mean, Canberra, if we think about it, if we go to 1913, when Weston arrived here and started to undertake his plantings, you know, it was really just dusty plains. It had been pasture land for all the countless sheep. And so as a result, we really needed to build a dense tree canopy. We needed protection from the winds, and we needed things that we knew would grow. So Weston set about the task, and he also liked the eucalypts. Perhaps not quite as much as Walter and Marion. Their love for the eucalyptus was just a little bit further and perhaps a little bit deeper. But for Weston, he liked their hardiness. He knew that they would grow. And so when I talk about the central land access and we think about that vision, you know, created in terms of a landscape design vision from Walter and Marion, it was very much complemented by the planting choices of Charles Weston. Just showing you a slide now of what was then known Prospect Park. It is now, of course, Anzac Parade. Charles Weston planted introduced species at that time. He chose hardy plant varieties that he knew would grow. But, you know, as time went on and the war memorial went into place, the plantings changed. And so we had the eucalyptus that sweeps along the land access to the war memorial, and we have the New Zealand hebes that form the planter boxes in that central line. And it's really this meeting of Charles Weston and the Griffins that bring about this juxtaposition, or this kind of this variation in the plantings, and perhaps even a tension that gives it the robustness that it has today. And now I'm going to show you a slide. So we're looking at what was called Prospect Park in 1920. It's now referred to, of course, as Anzac Parade. The defining thing, though, is that Parliament House, what's now Old Parliament House, was really just early foundations, but that very strong, sweeping land access was already very much in place. The Australian blue gums that framed that line have already started to grow. They're very densely planted. This was really, it's interesting because Canberra is known for its canopy of trees. It is very much a city in the landscape, and that's part of its value. And a lot of us think that that was part of the design feature. But have you ever planted carrots in your garden? I don't know. Well, when you plant carrots, once they pop up, especially if they're from seeds, then you do a bit of thinning out. Weston always intended to come back and thin out the trees. So he has very dense rows of trees. And that's part of our beauty, but it's actually a result of something that would have changed had he come back in later years. So just an interesting little fact for you about Weston. So let's talk tree varieties. I do love trees. Looking out the window, you'll see behind me the beautiful ornamental pear trees. Now, these were really the result of Charles Weston. Why he favoured these? I'm not entirely sure. It could have been that they were extremely hardy, they were European, and he knew that they would survive the Canberra winters. Also, though, they have this beautiful seasonal effect in the autumn. I'd like to think it was a combination of both for Mr. Weston. Okay, now if we go to the Griffins, we know they're fascinated by the eucalyptus trees, the gums, we've talked about that. But there was also this interest for Walter, and this had come from his training back in America when he studied landscape architecture. Walter really loved the idea of seasonal plantings, so that there'd be different flowerings at different times of the year. He wanted to incorporate this into the National Triangle and, of course, the central land access that we're speaking of. So when we look through, I'm going to show you another slide now. We're going to look up all the way through to Mount Bimbury, but going through Red Hill, there was a vision for bottle brush and banksias. So to get some rich reds, and then when we head the opposite direction to Mount Ainslie, the vision was for all these golds, and they were in the beautiful wattle trees that we know that are all over Australia today. So you can see he had these different ideas. He liked natives, but he also liked to mix it up with a few, you know, cork oaks, or the other thing that he liked, of course, were the maples from his homeland. So very much, you know, a mixed brew when you bring these two men together and all their plant varieties, but an absolute recipe for success, and I'm sure you'll agree. Okay, so just in conclusion, I want us to really think about the beautiful landscape city that we have today. It is a direct result of Mr. Weston, Mr. Griffin coming together. We know they didn't always agree. We know that one was dreamy, the other one was methodical, but it's that tension, it's that coming together, or perhaps even where they disagree, that we get this lovely result that we have today within the city. And when we look down that central land access, we will see this beautiful cultural landscape that has developed, and it's a meeting place for all Australians to come together. Thank you very much for listening to my talk today. I would love you to come and see us at the exhibition, and I would be happy to elaborate on any questions you might have. Thanks.